Good morning, everyone. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about power factor. So first, and this is the topic of power generation process. So before going on power factor, we have to understand some basic concept which is necessary to understand the power factor. In previous lectures, I have already discussed about different kind of loads, load factor, and your different kind of load curve. So you would be able to understand the power factor easily. Now we come to the next point, that what is our learning objective and outcome of this lecture. So the learning objective of this lecture is to understand the importance of power factor improvement, be knowledgeable about the selection aspect of power factor capacitors, and be able to conceptualize, judge, and select the right system. After this lecture, I'm expecting from the student that student will be able to understand the power factor of different load, and student will be able to understand active power and reactive power. So these are the learning objective and outcome of this lecture. Now these are the basic content of your lecture, which is your first we will discuss about some basics which is necessary for power factor, to understand the power factor, then tariff, then your power factor, what are the causes of your low power factor, what are the disadvantages of low power factor, and what method we can use to improve our power factor, and what are the advantages of power factor correction. So before going on these concept of power factor, first we have to understand the basics. Okay, so basics is your current voltage, power, resistance, inductance, and capacitance. So what is current? First we have to understand that what is current. So the flow of electron through a conductor is called current. It is always represented by I, and its unit is your amperes. Now voltage. So voltage is the driving force of electrons through a conductor, which is always represented by V, and its unit is in volts. So you can see in the diagram that this is your voltage and current. Now the next point is your power. So the product of voltage and current is power, and the unit of power is in watt. Now resistance is always represented by R, and it always opposes the flow of current, and its unit is in ohm. Next, inductance actually always opposes the sudden current change. So inductance is represented by L, and its unit is in Henry. Now capacitance C. So the capacitance is always used to store the electrical charge, and it is represented by C, and its unit is in farad. So the inductance is also energy storing element, which store the energy in the form of your electromagnetic field, and capacitance is also an energy storing device, which always store the energy in terms of electrostatic field, and its unit is in farad. Now Ohm's law. So what is Ohm's law? At the constant temperature, the potential difference between two endpoints of a conductor is directly proportional to the current flowing through the conductor. So V is proportional to I. When you simplify this equation, so V is equal to IR, where R is the constant and R is your resistance. So from this diagram, you can easily understand the voltage, current, and resistance and power correlationship with each other. So first we consider our power, which is the unit of power is in watt. And you can see from this diagram that the power, if you want to calculate the power, and the voltage and resistance is given, okay? So you can easily calculate the power by this formula, which is v square upon r. Now, if you want to calculate the power, if current and resistance is given, then you can calculate the power p is equal to I square r. Now, if you want to calculate the power and the voltage and current given, so this is very simple formula. You can easily calculate the power p is equal to vr. Now, this is the voltage. So, voltage is represented by v. And by these three formula, you can easily calculate the voltage. Suppose current and resistance is given. So, voltage is equal to IR. Suppose power and your, you know, current is given, then you easily calculate the voltage, which is equal to P upon I. If P and R is given, then you can calculate the voltage by this formula. Now, we come to the current. So, current, you can calculate the current if power and resistance is given. Then you can easily calculate the current by this formula. If power and voltage is given, the current will be P by V. And if V and R is given, so I is equal to V by R. Now, come to the next point. This is your resistance. If if you want to calculate the resistance and voltage and current is given, so you can easily calculate the resistance by this formula, which is V is equal to V upon I. And if voltage and power is given, then you can calculate the resistance by this formula, V square upon P. If P and I is given, then you can calculate the resistance by P upon I square. Now, let's come to the next point, which is very important to understand your for understanding the power factor. So, power factor is before understanding the power factor, we have to understand the reactance. So, what is reactance? The reactance is the non-resistive component of impedance in AC circuit. Okay. So, there may be your inductive reactance or it may be your capacitive reactance. If there is your inductive reactance, then inductive reactance is always represented by XL and it is equal to L omega, where omega is your angular velocity in radian per second. And omega is represented by where F is your frequency in hertz, okay? And L is the inductance, which is in Henry. Now, the next point is your capacitive reactance, which is denoted by XC, okay? And XC is equal to 1 by omega C, and omega is can be written as 2 pi FC. So, it is represented by XC, and C is capacitance, which has a unit of farad. So, these are the reactances, which can be divided into two parts. One is your inductive reactance and another one is your capacitive reactance. Now, impedance. So, impedance is the total resistance of an AC circuit. For example, in DC circuit, there is only a resistance which is denoted by R. But if you talk about your AC circuit, as well as resistance is present, and inductance and capacitance will also be present. So, this impedance can be divided into three parts. One is your RL circuit, another one is your RC circuit, next one is your RLC circuit. So, if the circuit is RL circuit, then the impedance formula will be Z is equal to root of R square plus XL square. If the circuit is your RC, then Z is equal to root of R square plus XC square. And if the circuit is RLC circuit, the impedance will be root of R square plus XL square of XL minus XC. So by these formulas, you can easily calculate the impedance of your AC circuits. Now we come to the power triangle to understand the power factor. So from this diagram, you can see that this horizontal component is representing your I cos phi, and this vertical component is represented by I sin phi. Okay, so where I cos phi is your active component current and I sin phi is your reactive component current. Okay, so from this triangle you can see that this is your active power, which is represented by P is equal to VI cos phi. Okay, if you multiply this voltage by these currents, okay, you will get this triangle, and the active power is equal to VI cos phi, and the reactive power is represented by Q is equal to VI sin phi, which is your this vertical portion, and this represent your apparent power, which is S is equal to VI. So this is your active power, this is your reactive power, and this is your apparent power, and phi is your power factor angle. So the angle between voltage and current, the angle between voltage and current is represented by phi, and phi is your power factor angle, and cos phi is your power factor. Okay, so we need to understand this cos phi, and we need to improve this component, which is your cos phi. So I cos phi is your active component of current, and I sin phi is your reactive component of current, and V and I are circuit voltage and current respectively. So impedance triangle can be represented by S is equal to root of P square plus Q square, where S is your apparent power, P is your active power, Q is your reactive power. And the total impedance can be represented by R square plus X square root of these two. So this is the diagram. Horizontal vector shows the resistance. Vertical shows your reactance, and this show your impedance. So Z is equal to root of R square plus X square. Now we have to understand what is your active power, what is your reactive power, and what is your apparent power. So active power is always represented by P, and the power which is actually consumed or utilized in an AC circuit is called active power or true power, which is represented by watt. So it is the active component of current and circuit voltage. So P is equal to VI cos phi is your active power, where P is your active power component, V is your voltage, I is your current, and cos phi is your power. Okay, so next is your reactive power, which is represented by Q, and the power which flows back and front or reacts upon itself is called as reactive power or wattless power. Okay, it is not actually have watt, it is only have reactive component. So the unit of reactive power is in VAR, voltage ampere reactive. So it is the reactive component of current, which is represented by I sin phi, and circuit voltage is V. So Q is equal to VI sin phi. Now, we come to the next point. Actually, reactive power is very important for the power factor improvement. Okay, so P is equal to VI cos phi is your active component, Q is equal to VI sin phi is your reactive component. Now, the product of circuit voltage V and the circuit I in an AC circuit is called apparent power, which is always represented by voltage amperes. Okay, so now I think it is clear to you that active power is the power which is consumed by the customer or consumer, and reactive power that flows back and front or reacts upon itself, and it is watt less power, that is your reactive power, and it is represented by Q. So this is all about your active power, reactive power and apparent power. Let's come to the next point, that is your tariff. So before understanding tariff, first we have to understand the cost of electricity. Suppose, for example, you are getting electricity in your house from you can say grid. So you are charging for the electricity. Now, the charge which you are paying, how the grid decide? Okay, so the charge which you are paying and the electricity charge which you are paying in terms of units. Okay, the unit which you are consuming, suppose if you are using 10 unit in a month, then you have to pay 10 multiplied by the charge which is decided by your grid station. Now, the point is, the cost of unit, how can we decide the cost of unit? So this is your tariff. So the rate or charge at which electrical energy is supplied to a consumer is known as tariff. And it includes cost for generation, investment cost for transmission, distribution, operation, maintenance and losses, along with penalty for consumers at low power factor. If so you can see that the cost of electricity is also depend upon the power factor. So this is most important to understand that how can we improve our power factor. Because your rate of charge or rate of charge of electricity is depending upon your power factor also. So the charge of electricity can be divided into many parts, like the type of tariff can be divided into simple tariff, flat rate tariff, block rate tariff, two port tariff, maximum demand tariff and power factor tariff. In the next lecture, we will and definitely discuss about the different types of tariff. Okay, so these are the different type of tariffs. By using these methods, the charge of electricity can be decided. Now, so first we have to understand that what is your power factor tariff. So maximum, if you talk about your KVA maximum demand tariff, this is always calculated by this formula, you know, kilovolt ampere. Volt ampere is your apparent power, okay, and which is equal to kilowatt upon power factor. Active power upon your cos phi. So P upon cos phi is equal to S, which is your S. Okay. Now, kilowatt R and KVA RH tariff. So, kilowatt RH is your, you know, reactive power, which is decided by this formula P upon cos phi into sin phi. So, sliding scale or average power factor tariff. So here the average power factor tariff is taken as 0.8 lagging. If you want to consider the power factor, so average power factor which is considered, that is your 0.8. If your power factor goes less than 0.8, then you will be penalized. And the power factor, if it is going above 0.8, then this is that you will get discount. So here the average power factor is taken as 0.8 lagging. If the power factor is less than 0.8, then the consumer will be penalized. If the power factor is greater than 0.8, then the consumer will get discount. Okay. Now there are different types of loads. So before understanding the power factor, we have to understand the different kind of loads. So one is your resistive load, the another one is your inductive load, and third one is your capacitive load. So these load are considered for the calculation of power factor. If your load is resistive, then you can see in the diagram that the voltage and current will remain in the same direction. Okay. So if the load consists of resistance, then the load is a resistive load and voltage and current are in phase, so there is no angle between voltage and current. So which results unity power factor? As you know, power factor is represented by cos phi. Phi is the angle between voltage and current. In resistive load, the angle between voltage and current is zero because both quantities are in same phase. That's why phi will be zero and cos phi will be one. So when load is resistive, then the power factor will be maximum and it consumes only active power supply. Okay. Now let's come to the next point, which is your inductive load. Okay. So what is your inductive load? If the load consist of resistance and inductance, then the load is your inductive load. And in inductive load, current always lag the voltage by some angle. So here I'm taking this, the angle is phi. And the problem is with this angle phi, because if your load is inductive, there will be always be some angle between voltage and current. Okay. It may be your 20 degree, 30 degree, 40 degree, 50, 60, or 90 degree. So the angle between voltage and current is always considered as your power factor angle. And in the case of inductive load, there will always be some angle between voltage and current. Okay. So this is your inductive load, and it always consume both active and reactive power. And the angle between voltage and current, which results lagging power factor, because current is lagging. So this always leads to lagging power factor if your load is inductive. So now I think you are able to understand your resistive load and inductive load. There are some example that the lamps and resistance heater is always comes into the category of your resistive. If you connect your induction motor and transformers, because they have coil, so they will consume some reactive power, and this is considered as your reactive load. Now we come to the next point, which is your capacitive load. So in capacitive load, you can see that this is your voltage and this is your current. We are taking voltage on x-axis, and there is some angle between voltage and current, which is denoted by phi. And you can see over here that the current is leading the voltage. So if the load consists of resistance and capacitance, then that load is a capacitive load.
So here voltage and current are not in phase. Voltage and current, which results leading power factor. So it consumes both active power and compensate reactive power. Our examples are capacitor and synchronous condenser for power factor corrections. So this is your capacitive load, in which you can easily, by using this capacitive load, you can easily control your power factor. We will discuss in our next lecture that how can we improve the power factor. So I think now you are able to understand that what is your power factor and how it depends on your resistive load, inductive load, or capacitive load. For example, there are two examples. One is your induction motor and another one is your overexcited synchronous motor. So you can see in the diagram, when an induction motor is connected to your load, this is your generator and this is your supply, which is connected to your induction motor. So you can see from the diagram that it is consuming kilowatt and it also having kVAr, which is lagging. Okay. So there will be a reactive power and there will be some power factor. Now, this is your overexcited synchronous motor in which it is consuming kilowatt, but it is supplying leading kVAr. Okay. So this is your overexcited synchronous motor. This is your lagging and this is your leading. Now, what is your power factor? So I think now you are able to understand that what is power factor. So power factor, the cosine angle between voltage and current in an AC circuit is considered as power factor. And the ratio of resistance and impedance of an AC circuit is also considered as power factor. And the ratio of true power and apparent power is also considered as power factor. So the voltage and so the ratio of resistance and impedance of an AC circuit, we have already done, that is equal to R upon Z, which is equal to cos phi. Okay. So this is the formula of power factor. If you take true power and apparent power, like cos phi is equal to P by S, is also represented by your power factor. Okay. Now we come to the point that you have resistive load. So in the case of resistive load, you can see over here that the power factor, angle between voltage and current is zero. So the power factor phi is zero and cos phi will be one. So for resistive load, the power factor is your unity. If you talk about your inductive load, here you can see that the current is lagging by some angle of phi. So for inductive load, the power factor is lagging. If you talk about capacitive load, for the capacitive load, power factor is leading. So the power factor is leading by some angle of phi. Now there are some factors, power factors, or some common loads which has the power factor. For example, we take incandescent lamp. It has power factor 1.0 because it is purely resistive. If you are taking arc lamp, that it has power factor of 0.3 to 0.7. If you are taking the power factor, which is your, if you are taking neon lamp, if your load is connected with neon lamp, then the power factor will be from 0.4 to 0.5. If you are taking fluorescent lamp, then the power factor will be 0.6 to 0.8. If you are taking resistive heaters, then the power factor will be 1.0. If you are taking induction heaters, then the power factor will be 0.85. If you are taking arc furnaces, then the power factor will be 0.85. If you are taking induction furnace, then the power factor will be 0.6. If you are taking arc welding, then the power factor will be 0.3 to 0.4. If you are taking resistance welding, then the power factor will be 0.65. And if your load is your inductive, then power factor will be 0.8. Okay. So these are some loads by which you can easily understand the power factor. Okay. So maximum power factor is for this lamp and resistance heater and induction motor, it is 0.8, and arc welding, it is very less, which is 0.3 to 0.4. So these are the different loads. You can see the power factor for these loads. Okay. Now, what are the causes of low power factor? Because low power factor is just because that there are some inductive load. If you are using induction motors, transformers, arcing or induction heating furnaces, lamps, arc lamps, then your power factor will be low. So these are some causes of low power factor. Number one is your induction motor. Second one is your transformers. Third one is your arc or induction heating furnaces. Fourth is your arc lamps and electric discharge lamps. And last one is your variable load. So these are the causes of low power factor. Now, there are some disadvantages of low power factor. So disadvantages of low power factor is the rating of alternator, transformer and switchgear increased in kilovolt amperes. The size of the conductor increases. The power loss in the system increases. Poor voltage regulation. System efficiency decreases. Penalty if power factor tariff. And overall cost increases. So these are the some disadvantages of low power factor. If you are having low power factor, then you have to face these challenges. Okay, if power factor is low, then rating of your alternator, transformer and switchgear will be increased. Switchgear means your circuit breakers and relays, which you are using in your grid. And the size of conductors will also be increased and the power losses will be high and voltage regulation will be less. System efficiency will decrease. And if your tariff is dependent on your power factor, then you must be charged some penalty and the overall cost of electricity will also increase. So it is very much needed to correct the power factor. Now, there are some methods by which you can correct the power factor. So poor power factor is most commonly corrected with the insertion of capacitor or a capacitor bank at the desired location to perform the correction. So the capacitor provides current that leads the voltage. This combines with the current associated with the magnetic fields that lags the voltage and cancels it out if sized correctly. Now, synchronous machine is also can be used to improve the power factor, okay, because it supply your leading current similarly to a capacitor. And the better power factor is always better power factor improvement is always depends on proper selection of size, location and methods. If you are not selecting proper size for power factor correction, if you are not selecting proper location for power factor correction, if you are not selecting proper method of power factor correction, it will not be beneficial. So these are the three points by which we can correct the power factor. So size of the capacitor can be decided by your system voltage. And there is some calculations by which we can decide the size of your capacitor's bank. So you can see that the capacitor current IC is equal to I1 sin phi 1 minus I2 sin phi 2. So I1 sin phi 1 is the reactive component before correction, and I2 sin phi 2 is the reactive component before correction. So the capacitor current IC is equal to I1 sin phi 1 minus I2 sin phi 2. And IC is equal to V upon XC. So XC is equal to 1 by omega C. And omega is equal to your 2 pi F. So by this calculation, you can easily calculate the size of the capacitor which is needed for power factor correction. So for example, if your system voltage is 3.3 kilovolt, 6.6 kilovolt, then you need 75 kVAr capacitor bank, which will supply 75 kVAr. If you are having 11 kV, then the capacitor which is needed, that is your 200 kVAr. If you are having 22 kV kilovolt system voltage, then you required 400 kVAr. And for 33 kV, you need 600 kVAr. This is the minimum rating of capacitor bank. And by this formula and this calculation, you can easily calculate that how much capacitors is required for power factor correction. So you can, first you have to decide the location of capacitor, series connection and parallel connection. These are the types of capacitor, and by which you can decide the location of capacitor where you have to locate the capacitors. Next is your, there are another methods which is your power factor correction. One is your static capacitors, synchronous condensers, and phase advanced condensers. So we will discuss about these methods in our next lecture. And there are some this is the reference of this lecture. You can go through these references. Okay. Now, these are some MCQs which is based on this lecture. So first, what is power factor? Is a ratio of, already I have told you that the power factor P is equal to, power factor is equal to cos phi. And this is the ratio of true power to apparent power. True power is your P and apparent power is your S. And this is the right answer. I have already told you P is equal to VI cos phi and S is equal to VI. If you divided your true power by the apparent power, you can easily get your power factor, which is equal to cos phi. So P upon S is equal to cos phi. Next one is your power factor can be mathematically expressed as. So power factor can be mathematically expressed as P upon Q, where P is your active power, Q is your reactive power, Q upon P, P upon S, S upon P. So P upon S can be mathematically, power factor can be represented. So third option is the right answer. Now the next question is your, the power factor angle of a purely inductive circuit is, purely inductive circuit, the power factor is your 90 degrees. So the options are given 45 degrees, 60 degrees, 75 degrees, and 90 degrees. So the right answer is your fourth option, which is your 90 degrees. Next, in a load comprising of resistance and inductance, in a load comprising of resistance inductance, if your load is consist of your resistance as well as it is having inductance, then load current lags voltage, load voltage lags current, both are in phase, any of the above. So you know in your inductive load, the current always lag the voltage. So load current will always lag the voltage. So load current lags voltage. Now, the next question is, the maximum value of power factor is. So the maximum value of power factor can be calculated. Power factor is equal to cos phi. Cos phi will be maximum when phi will be zero. So the cos phi have maximum value 1. So the maximum value of power factor is your 1. The next question is, the power factor of capacitive circuit is. As we know, in the capacitive circuit, the current always lead the voltage and power factor is always calculated in the terms of current. So it is leading power factor, and the answer for this question is your first option, which is your leading. Now let's come to the next question, which is, a circuit having poor power factor will draw. A circuit which have your poor power factor, it will always draw the high current. So options are given: no current, low current, normal current, and high current. So the right answer is your high current, and it will always draw on the high current. Next question is, the power factor of purely inductive circuit is. So the power factor of purely inductive circuit is, if your circuit is purely inductive, and you know in inductance the current is always lag the voltage. So the for inductive circuit, purely inductive circuit, the power factor will be lagging. So the options are given: leading, lagging, both of these, any of these. So the power factor will be lagging. So the second answer is the right answer. Now, next question is, a 500 kVA circuit drawing 200 kilowatt. So P is your, P is your active power, and circuit rating is given 500 kVA volt amperes, and an inductive load requires how much capacitance to obtain unity power factor. So you can easily calculate this question, and how much capacitance to be obtained. This is your 300. Okay. Now, improving power factor. So how can we improve the power factor? Reduce current for, if you want to improve, if you are improving the power factor, then what will be the effect of your circuit? It reduces current for given output. It increases loss in the line, increases the cost of equipment, all of the above. So A is the right answer. It reduces current for given output. So this is all about your power factor. And the last question is, power factor is a ratio of true power to apparent power. So this is all about your power factor. And in the next lecture, we will discuss about the different methods by which we can improve your power factor. Okay, thank you.